like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way.
And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we beseech you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of God's Word.
A reading from Isaiah. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All like sheep we have gone astray. We have turned, everyone, to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence. And there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading responsibly the appointed psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me?
In a heart so far from my cry and from the words of my complaint.
Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear.
In the night season also, but I find no rest.
But you remain holy.
Enthroned.
Our fathers hoped in you.
They trusted in you, and you delivered them.
They called upon you and were delivered.
They put their trust in you and were not confounded.
But as for me, I am a worm and no man.
Scorned by all and the outcast of the people.
All those who see me laugh me to scorn.
They curl.
He trusted in God that he would deliver him.
Let him deliver him if he will have that.
But you are he that took me out of my mother's womb.
You were my home when I was yet on my mother's breast.
I have been cast upon you ever since I was born.
You are my God, even from my mother's womb.
Oh, go not far from me. For trouble is near at hand.
And there is none to help me.
Many oxen have come around me.
Fat bulls of Bashan loathe me on every side.
They gape at me with their mouths.
Like a ravening roaring lion.
I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint.
My heart also.
My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my gums.
And you bring me into the dust of death.
For many dogs have come around me.
And the counsel of the wicked lay siege against me.
They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones.
They stand staring and looking upon me.
They part my garments among them.
And cast lots for my clothing.
But be not far from me, O Lord.
You who are my shepherd, hasten to help me.
Deliver my soul from the sword.
My life from the power of the law.
Save me from the lion's mouth. A reading from Hebrews. For since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come, instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law," then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, for all the more as you see the day drawing near. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John. Here begins the first verse of the 19th chapter. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him, and the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priest and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law. According to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the authority to release you and the authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone of Pavement, and in Aramaic, he said, "This is Gabbatha." Now it was the day of the preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the Place of a Skull, which in Aramaic is Golgotha. There they crucified him, with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier. Also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things by standing by the cross of Jesus, where his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wood stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was on the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came, and they broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. "Not one of his bones were broken." And again, another scripture says, "They will look on him whom they have pierced." The Gospel of the Lord.
Let us pray. Father, we pray that you grant us this evening wisdom and revelation of Jesus Christ crucified, the power and the wisdom of you, O God. Give us the courageous faith that we might be crucified with him, that through our death with him and burial in his baptism, we might be raised by your glory to newness of life. Through him by whom we pray, amen. Please be seated. Our gospel reading in John chapter 19 begins with Pilate taking Jesus and having him flogged. This would have followed Jesus' arrest, his abuse, his beatings, his mocking of him and the scoffing of him by the Jewish leaders and their henchmen, and undoubtedly followed beatings and abuse by the Romans as they took him to and from Pilate. And then Pilate had Jesus flogged, probably planning on punishing him and releasing him. But the Jews demand that he be crucified. And so following the crown of thorns placed upon his head, a crown that would have been made up of probably date palm thorns measuring 9 to 10 inches, that would have been placed around his skull, piercing his skin on his head and face, he is again turned over to be flogged and then crucified, the floggings being the 39 lashes with the whips made of metal and bones and rocks. And then he is told to carry his cross, and he carries it as long as he can before Simon of Cyrene takes it over for him. And then at 9 a.m, he's nailed to the cross and hoisted up on the cross to hang there in suffering and torment for 6 hours, half of which during that time, darkness would have covered the land. In addition to his physical pain, which is beyond imagination, more severe than I think we can even contemplate, he would have suffered emotional anguish and mental torment. And he became sin for us, taking on our sins upon the cross and then surrendering himself to his enemies of Satan and all the demons, as well as death itself. From that state of torture and distress upon the cross, the Gospels record Jesus expressing himself 7 times with statements. Now, we might imagine someone in that situation, nailed to the cross, suffering horrible pain and anguish and torment, that if they were to make any statements, they would consist of agonizing screams, perhaps cries for help, curses against those who were doing this to them, vengeance against all those who were there, or moans of despair, even cries to help, cries to God for help. But upon the cross, it's not an example of mere torture and agony, or even a mere sacrifice that Jesus undergoes. It is all of those things. But upon the cross, there is Jesus Christ, who is the demonstration of God's love for us, for all people. It is a demonstration of his own love for us and for all people. And it's a demonstration of Jesus' faithful, loving obedience and submission to the will of God. His love for people and his faithful obedience to the Father are expressed in the surprising words from the cross that are recorded in the Gospels. He makes these 7 statements, and each one is amazing to consider and to reflect upon, which I want to do this evening. The first statement in the synthesis of all of the Gospels is from Luke. Luke chapter 23, verse 34, where Jesus, being nailed upon the cross and hoisted up upon that tree in unimaginable pain and abandonment, his first statement is a prayer: Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus would have been looking at this horde of people, as described in Psalm 22, gathered about him, mocking and scoffing, having done the worst that they can do physically. And for them, he prays, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. It's an expression of what Jesus is accomplishing there on the cross. He is there for that very reason, that not only those who were present at his crucifixion, but all people at all times and in all places might be the recipients of the forgiveness for the very worst and all of their sins. Father, forgive them. Our reading from Hebrews chapter 10 today, describing what Jesus accomplished on the cross and in his resurrection, quotes from Jeremiah's prophecy, chapter 31, verse 34. The prophecy that was fulfilled right here in this statement. I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. That's the answer to Jesus' prayer. Father, forgive them, is to remember our sins no more. Not even to keep them in the back pocket, to pull out if he should so desire, but to truly remember our sins no more. That when we come to the Lord through Jesus, we don't have to wonder, is God going to punish us for some of those things that we do? For the blood of Jesus that was being poured out upon that cross washes our sins away, and they are forgiven in answer to his very prayer to the Father. The second statement that Jesus makes is also from Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, verse 42. Jesus is there on the cross, and as he's fulfilling that prophetic word that he would be numbered with the transgressors, as John tells us, he's crucified probably in the place that was meant for Barabbas, the insurrectionist, the rebel, who was released at the behest of the Jews instead of Jesus. And probably those two criminals on either side were rebels along with Barabbas. According to the Gospels, when Jesus is crucified and they are crucified with him, they both mock him. They both scoff at him and say along with others, "You saved others, save yourself and save us too." But according to the Gospels, at some point during those early hours, one of those criminals had an epiphany. He was enlightened by the Holy Spirit. His eyes were opened, and he experienced repentance. Maybe he was able to look from the corner of his eye at this one crucified beside him and see that there was something different about him. He was no ordinary criminal. He was no rebel like they were. He wasn't a thief or a robber. He was a quiet, gentle, humble man, praying forgiveness for those who were crucifying him. And this man rebuked the other criminal and said, "You and I, we deserve what we're getting, but he's done nothing wrong." And perhaps through the corner of his eye, looking as far as he could over to Jesus, he says, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." He must have heard, maybe Jesus himself teaching, maybe others talking about Jesus' teaching, about the kingdom of heaven that was sure to come. Maybe he somehow heard that Jesus, with the sign above his head, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, was king of a kingdom that was not of this world. And so he requests, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And maybe he thought, as probably would make sense, that if Jesus did come into a kingdom, he might just remember this man positively, saying something kind about him. If he came into a kingdom that he was able to invite someone into, maybe he would just let him come into a lower caste of that kingdom, sort of put him over there in the corner. But Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus, in his second statement, promises this man, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." He promises him that at the renewal of all things, when everything is made new, in the kingdom of heaven, this man will be with Jesus there in that paradise of God. And not just there, but there with Jesus. He's essentially promising to this man what Jesus promises in his letter to the church in Ephesus in the book of Revelation. He tells that church, "Those who have an ear to hear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God." Not only that, but one of the other latter promises to one of the churches, he says, to those who overcome, I will give the right to sit on my throne, just as my Father has given me the right to sit on his throne. This promise that Jesus makes to the man on the cross is what he is purchasing with his own blood on the cross. That he and that you and that anyone who believes can enter into the paradise of God and be with Jesus for eternity. This promise that he makes, I imagine Jesus spoke it while turning his head and looking at that man. Maybe they looked eye to eye, and that love that is in Jesus was conveyed to that man, that promise. This man knew was substantive, that he would be with him in paradise. And that promise is for you and for me. Imagine Jesus looking at you and saying, you will be with me in paradise forever. That's what he promises. That's what he's accomplishing on the cross. In our gospel reading today in John 19:26, we heard Jesus' statement to his mother and to his beloved apostle John, who are there at the foot of the cross. And while we can't imagine the pain that Jesus was suffering, I don't think we can imagine the experience, the torment of his mother watching her perfect son being crucified, being destroyed physically and tormented emotionally and mentally, being betrayed and abandoned by those he came to save, as that sword pierces her own heart. And there's Jesus' beloved disciple, John, probably not knowing what to do or say, but he's there. And Jesus looks at his mother and says, woman, behold your son. And to John, the disciple, behold your mother. Even upon the cross, his concern is for his friends and his mother, those who have stood by him, and the one who gave him birth and raised him and served him. His concern is that they not remain scattered or isolated or ostracized from one another, though that is exactly what the devil is trying to do to them. And God allows it in fulfillment of that scripture, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But Jesus does not desire for them to remain scattered, but to come back together, because part of what he is accomplishing on that cross and will complete in his resurrection and the outpouring of the Spirit on Pentecost is to create a new family of those adopted by the Father, of those given the spirit of sonship to cry, Abba, Father, the community of believers born again from above to be together forever. But knowing that while remaining in this world, they will have troubles, he calls them together. Woman, behold your son, and behold your mother. And this is what he is accomplishing among us and all believers. He's bringing us together as a family of faith, not to live this life isolated or separated, but to live this life together as one body under the headship of Jesus Christ. And so as he calls us to believe and to be saved, he calls us into the family of faith, to be planted and rooted in a church where we can grow together, producing fruit, bearing witness of what Jesus has done. And this is what the author of Hebrews encourages us in our reading today. In verses 24 and 25 of chapter 10, the author says, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. He brings us together, even as we anticipate his return. In Matthew and Mark's gospel, they record Jesus crying out with the first verse of Psalm 22 that was read today, that is being fulfilled upon the cross. They record him saying it in Aramaic, Ele, Ele, lama sabachthani, and then translate, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus is crying out to God, and he's crying out through the scriptures, which confirm for all those present, all those who read and hear of it, and for himself too, that what is happening on the cross is not an accident. It's not unexpected or unplanned by God or Jesus. What is happening upon the cross is in fulfillment of the scriptures that were inspired by the Spirit of God, that Jesus came and said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll." And throughout the events that we remember this Holy Week, it is to fulfill the scriptures. So he quotes the scriptures, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And we read that psalm and we can see the distress, the misery of both the psalmist and then as it's being fulfilled in Jesus. But that's not the end of the story, as that psalm continues in verse 22 to 24, it turns. And it says, "I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you." Jesus knows that he will stand again in the midst of the people of God, and he will praise his God and Father. And in verse 24, it says, "For he has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from him, but has heard when he cried to him." Jesus will not remain in death, separated from the Father. For his prayers, his cries have been heard and they've been answered. And he will see the face of God again, his Father. He will not be abandoned to the grave, nor will he see corruption. And then John tells us that after this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scriptures, "I thirst." And we can question that. What does being thirsty have to do with the scriptures? And why, at this point, does Jesus say, "I thirst," to those who have done this to him? And could any thirst be quenched by one? Could anyone's thirst be quenched who is being crucified? There's no way. There's no quenching the thirst of one who is crucified. There's no doubt Jesus is thirsty throughout this ordeal, but this thirst is a different kind of thirst that finishes the work upon the cross. If we look back to when Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and it says that he is distressed, that he's overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, and he prays three times, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Three times, "Father, if it's your will, remove this cup from me." And then as the mob comes to arrest him, John tells us that Simon Peter draws a sword and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. And Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" What Jesus is thirsting for on the cross is the fulfillment of him drinking the cup of God's wrath. That's the cup that in the garden, when he says, "Not my will, but your will be done," he takes that cup of God's wrath and he takes it in his hands, and upon the cross, he turns it to his lips and he drains it till there's nothing left. He thirsts to complete that work of taking God's wrath for sin upon himself, that we would not need to drink it, that there would be none left for you and I to drink. He drinks it for us in his thirst. In Luke 23:46, then Jesus called out with a loud voice and said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Throughout Jesus' life, even when the people abandoned him, he would say, "I'm not alone, for my Father is with me." His relationship to the Father is the most important thing during his life. And even now, he and the Father are one, he says. When you see him, you see the Father. Yet, as he becomes sin for us, as he enters into death, he is separated from the Father. Yet he knows he will not remain so. And as he gives up his life, he commits himself into the hands of God. And this too is fulfilling the scriptures. He quotes Psalm 31:5. Into your hands I commit my spirit. But that's not the end of the story or the end of the verse, which continues, you have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Jesus will not remain in sin. He will not remain in death or the grave or hell. For his God is the Redeemer. His God is the faithful God who will redeem him from sin and death and raise him in glory, where he will ascend into heaven and reign forever and ever. And that faithful God who redeems Jesus when he takes on sin and enters into death is the same faithful God who will redeem us. By grace through faith, he redeems us from our sin. He redeems us from death. He redeems us to himself in his kingdom forever. And so after Jesus has cried out, John 19:30, he says, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. It is finished. This work that he came to do is finished. It's complete. The Greek word is tetelestai. It means it's been paid for. The bill is paid. The work is done. There is nothing left to be paid or to be done. It is complete. We heard from Isaiah's prophecy today, chapters 52 and 53, which are prophecies about the suffering servant, that is Jesus. In that, it describes the work that this servant, the Messiah, will do. Verses 53, 4 through 6. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He describes it like this in Mark 10:35. He says, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. That's the work that has been completed. He has taken our iniquities. He has borne our griefs and taken our sorrows. He has given himself as a ransom for us so that we might be healed, body, soul, and spirit, so that our sins might be wiped away, and that we might live forever with him, which is the desire of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. All of this contributes to what Paul calls the demonstration of his love for us. That while we are yet sinners, Christ died for us. This is the love of God for us. I love what a 18th century Italian priest, now a saint, Alphonsus Liguori, says about this demonstration of God's love. He writes, who upon seeing a crucified God dying for our love could resist loving him? Those thorns cry out too loudly, those nails, that cross, those wounds, and that blood, all seeking to make us love him who has loved us so much. One heart is too little with which to love this God who is so in love with us. On the cross, Jesus is truly dying to be with you. That might be something that he would say to you tonight from the cross. For love of you, I am dying to be with you. Don't resist him who is dying to be with you. Receive this gift. Receive his grace. Receive the promise of eternal life, not just for someday, but for today. You can be with him, one with him, him and you and him. Peter, on the other side of the cross and resurrection and Pentecost, describes what Isaiah prophesied about and what Jesus accomplished. In his first letter, chapter 2, verse 24, Peter says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. If you need to return even closer to him tonight, come to him. Return to him, your shepherd. He's healed you. He's forgiven you. He's removed every obstacle between his love and you. Receive it and return that love to him. Let us pray. Father, Paul the Apostle writes in his letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verse 5, that the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. This love that was demonstrated upon the cross. Lord, fill our hearts with it. The love of Jesus, even in answer to his own prayer from John 17, that the love of the Father for the Son might be in us. We receive your love, Jesus. We receive your gift of salvation and eternal life. Give us a vision of being with you forever in paradise, and help us to live in light of it. We ask in your mercy and grace. Amen.
Thank you.
I invite you to kneel as you are able. Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent His Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him, and that all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with Him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs.
Let us pray for the Holy Church throughout the world, that the Lord our God may preserve her in unity, in peace, and safety, bringing into divine subjection all powers and principalities, and that He may grant us to dwell in such a peace and tranquility that we may show forth the glory of God.
Almighty Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Fill it with all truth, in all truth with all peace. Where it is corrupt, purify it. Where it is in error, direct it. Where in anything it is amiss, reform it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is in want, provide for it. Where it is divided, reunite it. For the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Let us pray for Alex, our bishop, and for Foley, our archbishop, that the Lord our God, who has appointed them to this office, may preserve them in health and in safety for the governance of God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, whose judgment upholds all things both in heaven and on earth, as you have appointed these your servants to be our bishops, so also defend them by your mercy against all adversities, that we, acknowledging you as our great shepherd and overseer of our souls, may so prosper by their care that we may bring forth the fruit of righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all bishops, priests, deacons, and ministers, and for all God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray for our nation's leaders and for all in civil authority, that they, knowing whose ministers they are, and may above all things seek God's honor and glory, and that we, remembering whose authority they bear, may faithfully and obediently honor them in accordance with God's holy word.
Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and whose power is infinite, we commend our nation to your merciful care, that being guided by your providence, we may dwell secure in your peace. Grant to our nation's leaders and to all in authority wisdom and strength to know and to do your will. Fill them with love of truth and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in your fear through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray to God, the Father Almighty, that He would cleanse the world from all evil, deliver it from pestilence and famine, set free those who are in captivity, restore the sick to health, and bring those who travel to a haven of safety.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all who are in heresy or schism, that the Lord our God may deliver them from all false doctrine and restore them to the faith and unity of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
O God of truth and love, who desires not the death of sinners, but rather that they should turn from their wickedness and live, look with mercy on those who are deceived by the lies of this world, the flesh and the devil, that the hearts of those who have gone astray may be restored to wisdom and returned to the way of truth in the unity of your holy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, that the Lord God, the Lord our God, may look graciously upon them, and that they may come to know Jesus as the Messiah and as the Lord of all.
Almighty and everlasting God, you establish your covenant with Abraham and his seed. Hear the prayers of your church, that the people through whom you brought blessing to the world may also receive the blessing of salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all those who do not believe in Christ, that the Holy Spirit may enlighten them through the gospel and bring them into the way of salvation.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you, as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have died in the peace of Christ and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. I brought you forth from the land of bondage and led you through the waters of salvation, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with the bread of heaven. I brought you into the land of promise, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. What could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you, my vineyard, to bear sweet fruit, but you have become very bitter to me and gave me vinegar for my thirst. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I passed over your firstborn and delivered them from death, and you have delivered me into the hands of my enemies. I led you in the pillar of cloud, and you have led me into the judgment hall of Pilate. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I struck down the kings of the Canaanites for your sake, and you struck my head with a reed. I gave you a royal inheritance, and you have crowned my head with thorns. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I opened the rock and gave you to drink from the water of life, and you have opened my side with a spear. I raised you on high with great power, and you have hanged me high upon the cross. O my church, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us.
Thank you.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. If we have died with him, we shall also live with him. If we endure, we shall also reign with him. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, peace and rest to the dead, to your holy church unity and concord, to us sinners everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen.